Hello everyone, my name is Hunor and let's talk about coding SVGs. And before we even start, you might be wondering, why would anyone code an image? If you only want to have a static image, you might be better off with Illustrator or some other tools. But SVGs become very powerful once you start combining them with JavaScript. You can create animations, or you can generate a diagram, or an infographics, or anything that can be data-driven. You can even make SVGs interactive. Unlike other image formats, SVGs don't behave like a black box. You can assign event handlers to parts of an image. You can even take this to the next level, like with this logic gate simulator. This one is fully interactive. If you change the inputs, the output will change. You can drag these elements around, you can add new ones, and you can connect them. And this whole application is basically an SVG image. And to show you a last example, here's the Gorillaz game that we already covered on this channel. This is a bit of an Easter egg because this one is not an SVG. As we covered, it's using HTML canvas. But under the hood, SVG and HTML canvas has a lot of similarities. We are going to get back to this when we are covering the curves in this video. Now with this introduction, let's see the code of an SVG. This one is a very simple one. It basically draws a circle. For a while, you can inline the code of an SVG inside HTML. And that's when it becomes very powerful. Of course, there are some rules here, like we cannot have a header element inside the SVG, and we cannot have a circle element outside of it. So inside SVGs, we have to use elements specific to SVGs. Now this whole thing we can generate from a React component or any other library we are using, for instance Vue.js. This one is returning the HTML element itself, but we could also return the SVG element or part of an SVG. We can even break down an SVG into multiple components if it's more complex. Now let's have a closer look to the SVG element. The SVG element has a couple attributes. It has a width, a height, and a view box. Here we have two images. One is 100 by 100 and one is 200 by 200. We are defining these sizes with width and height. But what's interesting is that the view box in both cases is the same. And even the content of the images are the same. In both cases, we are defining a circle with a radius of 50. Now, how is this happening? Because the one on the right is obviously bigger. This is because of the viewBox property, which is defining the coordinate system. In both cases, we say that the top left corner of the image is starting at 0, 0, and the size of the coordinate system is 200 by 200. Even though one is actually smaller, the image elements think of the image space as a 200 by 200 canvas. That's why the two images appear differently, even though they have the same coordinate and the same radius. Now this viewBox property doesn't have to start with 0, 0. For instance, we can also define the top left coordinate with minus values. For instance, in this case, we start at minus 100, minus 100. And in this case, the origin of the coordinate system is going to be at 0, 0. In this case, we don't even have to specify that the circle is at 0, 0, because that's the default. There's often also an XML namespace property, which is a long string. But if you are using an SVG inside HTML, then we don't need that. Now let's talk a bit more about this circle. As we saw it before, we define a circle by defining its center coordinates with cx and cy. In this case, the center coordinate is at 100, 100. We also define a radius, and that's all we need. By default, this will result in a black circle. If you want to define the color, we have to define the fill attribute. In this case, we set it to red. But here we can set any other value that is valid in CSS. We can set a hex color value, we can use the RGB function, we can use the HSL function, Anything that's valid in CSS, we can use here. The fill attribute is kind of like the background color attribute in CSS. Now what if, instead of filling this circle, we want to set its border color? In this case, we have to set the stroke and the stroke width attributes. They behave almost like the border color and border width attributes. If you want to avoid a circle being filled with a black color, we also have to set the fill attribute with the value none, because otherwise the default value will be black. Now what's cool about having SVGs inside HTML is that we can move all these styling properties to CSS. We can define a class name for this circle element and move the styling properties to CSS. There are two kinds of properties though. The ones that define the shape of the element, like the coordinates and the radius in case of the circle, we cannot move into CSS. We can only move the fill and the stroke attributes in this case. Now, of course, apart from circles, we can draw other elements. For instance, we can draw a rectangle. This is very similar to the circle, except now we have the top left coordinate with the X and Y attributes. And then we set the width and the height properties. Styling is the same as with a circle. If we want it, we can set the fill and the stroke attributes. Now with this knowledge, we can already draw a diagram. For instance, we could generate a diagram from React where we have some data points and we map these data points into a rectangle where we bind the X, Y, and height attributes to these data points. Now, circles and rectangles are nice, but let's talk about the path element. If you open any SVG file that you find on the internet, it's going to contain a path element. And the path element is going to have a very long definition attribute, which looks more like gibberish. So let's break it down and let's see what's inside of it. In this case, we are drawing a simple line. The definition of the path element can be broken down into multiple segments. For instance, in this case, we have a move to and a line to segment. They both define a coordinate. We move the pen to this coordinate, to 50, 100, and then we draw a straight line to 150, 100. Everything inside the SVG element is defined by coordinates. Now with the same logic, we can draw a hamburger menu icon. We follow the same pattern. We have a bunch of move to and a bunch of line to commands. What's interesting here is that this one is still a single element, even though it's not continuous. You can have multiple move to commands inside the definition of a single path. Now, if you think about it, how often did it happen to you that you need the hamburger menu icon or some other simple icon, and then you downloaded an icon library or you used some other over-engineered ways? With SVGs, it's actually only a couple lines of code, and you can fully customize the look. You can change the color, you can change the stroke width. We can even add this stroke line cap property, which will make the lines rounded. To show you another simple example that's also using move to and line to commands is the full screen icon. We're not going to go into the details of this one, but it's basically the same. We just move to some coordinates and then we draw straight lines and we repeat that a couple of times. Instead of that, let's talk about this sun icon. Let's say you have a website which is supporting dark mode and light mode, and you want to create a toggle button which shows an icon for the sun and for the moon. Now let's see how to create this icon. First of all, we draw a circle. And I want to highlight that in this case, the width and height is not matching the view box. This icon here is appearing to be quite big. Its size is 200 by 200. But the view box is defining a coordinate system that is 30 by 30. And it's also starting at minus 15, minus 15, which means in this case, the center of the image is going to be at 0, 0. Now let's draw a straight line for one of the sun rays. This pad is very similar to what we had before. It has a move to and a line to command. Now this is nice, but how do we draw the other sun rays? We could figure out the different coordinates, but we need to use some trigonometry for that, and we want to avoid it in this case. Instead of that, what we can do is set an ID for this element and reuse it. We can use the use element to copy this element and apply a transformation. For all these other sun rays, we apply a transformation, we apply a rotation here. In order to make this work, we had to center the coordinate system, because the rotation is applied around the origin. We can do a lot more cool things with rotation only. For instance, we can create a windmill. For this windmill, we have a couple more things we haven't discussed so far. At the bottom, we have this path element, which is serving as the foundation, as the stand. And then we have this group element that contains the wall head. The group element is basically like a div element in HTML. You can group things together, you can set an ID for them, you can apply transformations that apply for the wall group, and you can apply properties that will cascade down to the children. Here again, we have a circle, we have a path that we are reusing and rotating to have these three arms. Inside a path, we have again a move to and a couple line to commands. And we also have a cubic Bezier curve command, which we are going to cover in a bit. This cubic Bezier curve is this curvy part close to the circle in the middle. Now we have an ID for this wall group, and with this ID, we can define a keyframe animation in CSS. Here we are animating the rotate property just as before. The rotate property is a relatively new syntax. Earlier you had to use transform rotate, but now you can do the shorthand and just simply animate rotate. With rotation, we can also create a watch or a clock. Of course, this one is not animated from CSS. Here we're using JavaScript to set the time. This clock is also interactive. If you click this number here, which is showing the date, then it will change to an AM/PM indicator. Now, so far we got to this. We can draw a circle, we can draw a straight line, but in order to have a proper smiley, we need to bend the line. We need to use curves. Now, how can we do this? In SVG, there are multiple curves. The simple one is called quadratic Bezier curve. Here again, we start with a move to command, and then we have a quadratic Bezier curve command, which starts with a Q letter. Path segments always continue the previous segment. This quadratic Bezier curve doesn't have a starting point. That's why we have to start it with the move to command. Here this coordinate is defined with the move to. And then the endpoint of this curve is defined by the quadratic Bezier curve. Each segment usually not just continues the previous path segment, but also ends with a coordinate that will be the endpoint of the segment. Before that, in this quadratic Bezier curve segment, we have another coordinate, which we call the control point. This control point defines how to bend the line. You can bend it more, you can bend it less. If you move it in line with the two other coordinates, then we just have a straight line. And of course, it doesn't have to be in the center. You can move it sideways, you can move it left and right, and you can bend the line the way you want. Now, if you get back to the gorilla's example, in this case, we had a simple quadratic Bezier curve. We had the starting point around the shoulder, and the endpoint as the hand. And we had a control point somewhere in between. And while we are aiming, we only move the endpoint. We keep the control point at the same position, and you can bend the line in weird ways if you really try, but just by moving the endpoint, we have this quite a right animation here. Now, quadratic Bezier curves are nice, but they have some limitation. We can't really make big bulky curves. For that, we can use the cubic Bezier curve. A cubic Bezier curve is very similar to a quadratic Bezier curve. In this case, we also start with a move to command, and this path segment is also ending with the endpoint. But before the endpoint, we define two other coordinates, one for the start and one for the end. And what's interesting here is that you can create bigger, bulky curves. But also, if we change only one of these control points, it doesn't really affect the other one. Like if I'm dragging this coordinate here, of course the wall walker is changing, but the endpoint is still having the same finish. Now, why is this interesting? Cubic Bezier curves are very useful when we want to connect different path segments. Like in these cases, we have two straight lines in each image. Like here we have a straight line, and then here we have a straight line. And then we want to connect these with a cubic Bezier curve. And we can do this in a way that it doesn't look like the line is broken. There's no inflection point here. The transition is smooth. And we can do this by aligning the control points with the path segment before and the path segment after. We have this in both cases. On the image on the right, we have two line segments which are crossing each other. And then we have this bulky cubic Bezier curve that is connecting these two lines without breaking the line. It looks like we have a smooth connection. Now, for the most part, you can do a lot of creative stuff with straight lines, cubic Bezier curves, and quadratic Bezier curves. But if you want to overcomplicate things even more, then you can use the R command. The R command, still following the same pattern as we had before, we start with a move to, and the end of the R command is defining the endpoint. But before that, we have five other parameters. This visualization might be a bit misleading because here we have the center of this arc, but actually that's none of the properties. I just have this here to simplify this explanation. The other properties include two radiuses, because it's not even a circle arc, but it's an elliptic arc. So you can have two different radiuses. You can also make a circle if you set these two values to the same, but otherwise you can have an ellipse. And after having these two radiuses, we can also apply a rotation. And even with all these, we have four different options, because the arc is still going from a starting point to the endpoint. And you can reach this endpoint counterclockwise or clockwise, which is a Boolean flag in the properties. And we can reach this endpoint the short way or the long way, which is another Boolean property, which we just changed from 0 to 1. Now, arcs are fairly complex, but you barely ever need it. At least so far in my hobby projects, I wasn't really using arcs. But in case you need it, you can find more about it in the SVG tutorial. So that was a quick introduction, and I hope you enjoyed it. If you want to learn more about SVGs, check out svgtutorial.com, where you can go through 25 basic examples, from simple shapes to more interactive ones. And of course, like and subscribe, and check out my other YouTube videos about SVGs. See you at the next one.